are going to be two parts to this talk. There were five challenges. And before I start talking about the challenges, a few words about me and the lab so that we can put the work in perspective. So I work in the area of signal processing and machine learning these days, because signal processing is slowly evolving to include a lot of machine learning and artificial intelligence in its fold. And the signal processing and machine learning AI work that I do is specifically in two areas. One is core comm, core communication, and the other, not the core network communication, but core communication concepts. And the other is in the area of computer vision. In today's talk, we're going to focus on computer vision aspects of the next gen telecom systems. And the second part, which is on Monday or the 27th, is going to be on communication aspects and how you can use AI and ML in some communication algorithms that you need to use. So we've had extremely good participation in terms of people from the industry and academia who've joined me in making this set of challenges happen. So, you know, I will, of course, be talking to you again on Monday. So without further ado, let's get to the challenge themselves. So let me start by sharing the part one today. So is the presentation visible to, well, the panelists can let me know. So yes. Thomas, is it visible?
Yes.
Okay, great. So let me just walk the audience through three of the challenges that we've come up with. So today what I'm going to do is talk about challenge number 19, 23, and 20. The first challenge is on unstructured road conditions that exist in the country, meaning India and other similar developing countries, where we are not able to invest as much on infrastructure, or you know, the way the people behave on roads is slightly different from what you would see in the developed part of the globe. The second one is an extremely interesting area, which is the challenge on shared experience. This is something that was in any case becoming popular, but with the advent of COVID, which has largely been not such a good thing to have happened to all of us, but it has in a way paved the way for telecom and ICT to move forward. Now, shared experience is about meeting people online, and while you meet online, how can you have a more enriching interaction and even enjoy some events or some happenings together? So this is something that I will talk about. And the third challenge, of course, is something that the world has been struggling for quite a number of years now, possibly a couple of decades. Ever since the advent of video conferencing, people have been struggling to make it more and more immersive, more and more natural in terms of using it, and also making the experience richer, both in terms of experiencing it and in terms of being able to make the other person see your point of view and be able to transmit as much information as you could possibly want. For all three challenges, I'm going to start with introduction. We are going to talk about the background and a brief objective, followed by a discussion on the scope, which would be discussed in a little more detail. And finally, I'll try to walk you through some of the data sources and tools that are available. You are not limited to using these tools and data sets for the challenge. These are the suggested tools. You could look for other free tools if you want and use them as well. So now let me start with the challenge on unstructured road conditions. I did not want to use the word chaotic, but that probably is a more appropriate representation of the kind of conditions we encounter. So, and before I start, the lead for this challenge is Dr. Prerna Mukherjee. She is a faculty member at Jawaharlal Nehru University in Delhi. So she is going to mentor the people who apply for this challenge. So I've given her email ID here. If you have any specific questions, you can contact her after this presentation or at any point that you find convenient. So essentially, we're going to talk about smart transportation, and we're going to talk about smart transportation in conditions of these kind. These are not synthesized images. These are real images from Indian roads. So this is the, and this is not to say that this is the only kind of roads that you will encounter. But then on the other hand, you will encounter this kind of traffic very, very often. You travel from one city to another. All of these five scenarios is something that you will encounter at some stage. Drive 500 kilometers in any direction, and if not all, at least majority of these is something that you will encounter. Now, the problem is that it is difficult to you make your vehicle move around autonomously, even if everything around you is disciplined and structured. But the problem becomes even more acute when you have a scenario which is very, very difficult to first understand and then continually understand, because it's not as if it is going to stay chaotic in this manner. The kind of chaos that you will encounter could change with time. So in the previous slide, when I go back to it, talks about some of the kind of scenarios that you will encounter and the kind of scenarios that you can work on improving in this particular challenge. You will find this very often, unmarked or lanes which are incompletely marked. And the road signs at some places are missing, and other places they are incorrect, and at some other places they are covered with other signs. So what happens is you end up with having to move on in conditions that even though they wish to, they cannot provide you information about where you headed, where you are, and what to expect. This is as far as the infrastructure is concerned. Now, what happens is when you get onto the road and you don't know where you headed because of the first problem, you all of a sudden encounter heterogeneous traffic. So you have two-wheelers, three-wheelers, four-wheelers of all sizes, trucks from all years of manufacturing going back to 50 years, even in some places in the country, and some unregistered vehicles. People have put them together using their ingenuity, and then you have pedestrians who also join the chaos and do not follow rules at some times. So you have unmarked roads, so the infrastructure doesn't tell you anything, and what happens is around you, you've got traffic of all kinds. And then the problem becomes even worse, because this condition does not prevail uniformly. So you could have areas where you suddenly have large number of two-wheelers around you, and then you could move to another place where you have very, very nice roads and traffic moving in lanes and all the lanes marked and all the road signs giving you the right information. So it isn't as if you could design your driver assistance system to handle slow moving heterogeneous traffic on bad roads, which are poorly marked. And then what happens is sometimes when you encounter roads which are not properly marked, they might also be in a bad state of upkeep. So you could end up with potholes that appear after rains. You could have rugged terrains, especially in highways. And to top all of this, there is this unpredictable behavior of traffic agents, including pedestrians and other vehicles. So a lot of times in India, you might find vehicles straddling two lanes. Both the lanes are empty, but they will choose to straddle both the lanes. And then you could have somebody who is following lane discipline. Now you have to make sure that you handle both of these kind of scenarios. You cannot expect it to be incorrect traffic behavior at all times. Sometimes you might encounter correct traffic behavior also. So what has happened is people have, the drivers especially, have developed techniques and mechanisms to handle this chaotic scenario. But when you build an autonomous system, you try to make it well-defined, you want to make it rule-based, you want to make it as predictable as possible, which is, you know, something of a non-impossibility, because the behavior is unpredictable. So you cannot have a predictable solution when you have behavior which is unpredictable. So how do you learn all of that and drive like the other drivers do? And then this is not the only reason why you'd want to do it. The problem is, and most of you would, after having seen the conditions of the road and these four or five bullets I have here, that, you know, what does it mean in terms of accidents? And it is no surprise that there are as many as 150,000 deaths every year that occur due to road accidents. And these are the numbers for which we have records. There might be a larger number which go unrecorded. And most of these, actually 60% of them occur in night driving conditions, because you can understand that the complexity and the difficulty levels become even higher. So the fundamental objective of this challenge is twofold. One is, you could either focus on scene understanding. You could pick up any of these unstructured, unpredictable, difficult to handle scenarios and come up with a scene understanding, which could later be fed into an engine for inferring. Or you could provide a real-time recommendation engine, assuming that somebody has understood the scene for you, or you might wish to pick up raw sensor data and operate on it directly. So either of those two things are possible, or you could do a combination of the two. So fundamentally, the objective here is either you understand the scene in a chaotic traffic scenario, or provide real-time recommendation based on the inputs that you can acquire. So with this background, let me now move on to some of the things that you could possibly do. Now, since I have three presentations to make, and I'm going to spend about 10 minutes in each one of them, so I might speed up a little now. But if there's something that you want me to talk about, please put that as a Q&A. We'll come back in the end. Now, this is what we hope that you people will contribute to. So there are many, many aspects that we have here. There is, for example, parameters from sensors that are within the vehicle. You could have sensors outside the vehicle, or you could have sensors which are not mounted outside the vehicle, but mounted on the traffic infrastructure that you have in your cities or villages or highways. To this, you have to add knowledge of having grown up in Indian conditions. You could either collect this from data that's around you, or you could use your knowledge from having been here, or talk to people who know about it. So these are the kind of inputs that you can give to a system that you're going to build. So you have sensors inside your vehicle, you have sensors outside your vehicle, which could be mounted on the vehicle or on traffic infrastructure. And then you have an understanding of the behavior of people on the road. You have the model of animal behavior, the condition of the roads, and many other such things. And all of this goes in, and it can either recommend something to the driver, or it can drive on its own. So a lot of work on ADAS is being done, but a lot of work on ADAS is being done in the structured environment. If you end up with unstructured environment, a better way to go is a recommendation engine. Give driving directions to the driver, and he can choose to use them or not use them depending on what makes sense in the current scenario. So ADAS is not what we're looking at. And when we say a lot of work has been done, a lot of work has been done in structured environments. So there is enough work in structured environments, and two, you do not have a structured environment. So we are hoping that a lot of people who participate in this challenge will look at the recommendations being generated for the drivers rather than increasing autonomy in the vehicle itself. A few parameters that one has to be careful of. This is the amount of time it takes for the driver to get information of what's going on around him, 2 to 10 seconds. And the time he has to respond is the time in which he can respond is 2 to 10 seconds. It's a minimum of 2 to 10 seconds. And now what happens is we do not want the recommendation engine to add additional overhead. So what we are looking at is that you should not have more than 1 second of analysis time from the recommendation engine that you try and build. So we're looking at real-time recommendations, and the recommendations could be of any of these type. You know, it could be apply brakes, or it could be accelerate, or maintain distance, or reduce distance, or whatever else. And there are two or three ways in which you can do this, and these are just suggestions. You could also look at other avenues for making this happen. The first is vehicle to X, which means the other vehicles, pedestrians, or infrastructure. You could communicate with all of them. This is possibly the smartest way of having good road manners for vehicles and pedestrians. Everybody is able to communicate with everybody else, and everybody is able to communicate their intent, location, and the size of the vehicle to everybody else. And this will ensure that people can optimally utilize the roads that are available to you. Now, what happens is the kind of information you need is type of vehicle, traffic density, how does the current driver respond to those kind of things, and stuff like that. And there's a lot more. So a lot of this information can be made available from a vehicle to all other vehicles. And some of this can be drawn from the infrastructure. Some of it could be from pedestrians who are on the roads. And what is going to happen is that there will be temporal changes in the topology. So what you encounter in terms of road conditions or traffic conditions will change with time and with location. And you need to look at multicast routing mechanisms so that the information reaches the person it should reach to in time. The challenge, of course, is that every vehicle or every entity on the road should have V2X capability, because if even one entity on the road does not have this capability and you're relying entirely on V2X, that is recipe for disaster. And that is not happening anytime soon. However, the idea is to look at the future. So if some of you are interested in taking this kind of work forward, they are welcome to do that. And this is an idea of some work that we've done in our lab here. This was a collaborative driver assistance. There are two examples that we show here. One was by using the GPS location of the drivers and having a map of the roads, you could warn the drivers of potential collisions at traffic intersections. The other was if you identify an obstacle on the road using some of the sensors that you have, you do the processing on the cloud and an alarm sounds in the car that there's an obstruction or a potential obstruction, you should take evasive or relevant action so that you can save yourself from a collision. The second approach is camera based. And when I say camera based, there are also lidars that I include in the setup. And of course, stereo rig is multiple cameras, and then you could have 360 degree cameras which could be implemented as a single device or as multiple devices. But the idea is capturing optical information inside and outside the car. So this is also extremely attractive because most of us look and make sense of our surroundings using vision. So if you come up with mechanisms to understand the scene around you, then vision is usually a good tool to use. The drawbacks, of course, are that cameras don't always work. Examples of this are that when you have extreme mist and fog, you find it extremely, extremely difficult to see the road yourself. Similarly, the cameras also start failing. Poorly lit roads, nighttime driving, high beam driving by drivers coming from the other side, all of these are problems that need to be solved for you to be able to see the other vehicles. And there's also the occlusion issue where you might have a very large vehicle driving right in front of you. So there are challenges and there are opportunities here. So some of you might want to look at camera and associated sensor based solutions. And this is something that we did here in the lab, and I had wanted to show this, but since we are running out of time, I will not run this, but this was a solution where we were able to track pedestrians, and we were, of course, before we tracked them, we were able to detect them. Multiple pedestrians on the road were detected, and then we tried to track them so that we could eventually predict what direction they are moving. Are they going to move along the road, or are they going to attempt to cross the road at some stage? So this is another area that you could look at. We had relied on handcrafted features, but given the strength of neural networks, some of you could start looking at neural net based techniques for achieving the same goal. And then there is another example here of automatic identification of potholes. Potholes are a kind of obstruction. The size of some potholes that you encounter in countries like India is quite frightening, and you cannot drive very fast into these potholes. So early detection of such potholes is extremely, extremely important, not just to avoid them, but also to avoid sudden braking. So this was some work that the group did on identification of potholes on roads. And the third thing is that you could look inwards. What you could do is try to look at the road from the driver's point of view. He can only see 60 to 120 degrees of view at any point in time. You could also understand the attention level of the driver. You could understand the road conditions, time of the day, time of the year, and those kind of things, traffic scenarios, any other information that you might have. And all of these can be integrated into the solution so that driver's behavior can be incorporated into the solution itself. And these are some of the data resources that you might want to look at. And like I said, you can also look at other resources as long as they are freely available. And also there are no restrictions on this problem statements. It's open to all participants from all countries and all backgrounds. You could be a student or you could be working in an organization. It's open to all. These are some data sets that you might want to look at before you choose this as an area. This will give you some idea of the kind of complexity that you are struggling with. And these are some papers that could get you started. With this, I'll move to the second challenge. For this challenge, you should contact Neeraj Kumar. His mail ID is given right here. You could also contact Ankur. They both are in the same team. I think Ankur is Neeraj's boss. You could talk to either one of them. This is challenge number 23, and this is about shared experiences. And when I talk about shared experiences and immersive experience, there is a thin, fine line that divides the two. In shared experiences, there has to be content from beyond what is being generated by the participants. So you could be watching a movie together. That's a shared experience. So movie is a content that has to form part of the ecosystem. You could go to a virtual holiday together. So what is that place like? What is the scenery like? What are the things that you can do there is content that is outside the scope of what the two or more participants are generating themselves. So you will see a lot of augmented and virtual reality, both in shared experiences and immersive experiences. But in shared experiences, you will also need to curate content to make the experience richer, to have content from beyond what is generated by the participants themselves. So where are we today? So this is just a quick introduction. More and more people are networking with each other online. It isn't the days gone by where people had to meet each other face to face to interact and get to know each other better. More and more interactions and even strong relationships are being evolved and made stronger online. So how can you enhance the experience there? How can these people experience things together? And this is by no means a difficult task, because content can be brought into the entire ecosystem because of VR and AR gadgets that have become extremely, extremely popular. Internet, which is very reliable, which is high bandwidth, which is low latency, and you have devices which are very, very capable. So given that you have these three technologies and devices available with you, it is actually possible to enrich shared experiences. And the third thing that has made huge strides in the last few years is deep learning models. And these deep learning models make it possible for you to generate richer and richer experience, which is closer and closer to to as natural as possible. And Unity and Unreal are some softwares which help you render realistic VR, and there are others for AR renderings as well. Now here again, I had something that I wanted to show you, and if I have time, I'll show them in the end. So these are some VR AR gadgets. The first one is a gadget that will help you experience aromas. So you put this up on your face and you can smell what the other person is smelling, fragrance, and you could enhance it and at least on the face feel the temperature. So the level of experience is enhancing. The modality is no longer restricted to speech and video. There are other senses that can also become part of the experience. So fragrance is one of them. The second example here is about haptic feedback. So you can actually experience hard and soft objects. So you touch something and by the haptic feedback, you can actually feel it to be a wall, or you could feel it to be a soft substance. All of us, most of us who use Apple products already have experienced haptic feedback, and it is so real that it is almost impossible to know that the trackpads, for example, are not actually moving. It's just haptic feedback that is making you experience what it wants you to. The third example here is bringing experiences to life. So you look at something on in 2D, it becomes a 3D object and interacts with the surroundings. And the fourth one here is the person is virtually attending. Maybe this was probably a newscast, or you could have them participating in conferences. With the advent of holography and a lot more 3D rendering capabilities building up with time. So you may have a headset in which you can experience 3D, or you could actually have holographic projections where you could experience 3D. So this is just the motivational part. I will come to the exact scope of or objective of the challenge in a minute. Before that, these are some of the VR AR industry use cases. The first one is handheld AR, augmented reality. It can be used for marketing. For example, how would your house look if it had this furniture? How would this dress look on you? It could enhance gaming. It could enhance educational experience. Then you have location-based experiences. When you are at a particular place close to a shop, for example, you could get relevant advertising. And then you have outdoor mobile augmented reality, where depending on where you are, you could get more information about the area of interest. So you could, for example, if you're at a monument, you not only see the monument, but you also get relevant information about the monument and possibly cues on how to get back home or eat or drink someplace. So augmented reality is something that is finding more applications with each passing day. And before I talk about the exact challenges, there is this notion of being and space in virtual environment. This is something that is becoming popular, and there are more than a few companies who are looking actively at providing the experience of being and space in a virtual environment. And through your avatar, you can have a very, very immersive experience, true in some sense. And while you're in that space, you can interact with multiple participants and have a realistic representation of the environment. So shared experiences can be richer than immersive experiences that VCs give you. You actually move into a virtual space and you have your avatar interacting with other participants and the environment. So now these are the challenges that we sort of thought people could look at. So there are limitations in creating immersive experiences. You're giving them a feeling of togetherness, co-presence, a shared virtual space. How do you make it appear that the two of you are sitting next to each other watching the movie? How do you make the experience more realistic that the two of you are hiking together? How do you make the shared visual space appear realistic to both based on how you want them to be present together in that environment? The second challenge that you face is related to the quality of the algorithm and the devices and the underlying networks. You could have latencies and you could have fidelity issues because of the accuracy with which you can render some things or activities, or how much correct information you have, or how true is the information that you have about the environment. And there is limitation in diversity of activities in virtual environment. And this these limitations will keep reducing as and when we get more and more devices that can make a lot more activities in the virtual environment possible. You know, for example, a full bodysuit with haptic feedback and Oculus can make you experience a hype. But the level of experience will improve with time. So you could pick up any of these challenges and you could look at improving them. So you could increase the spatial connection. You can increase the feeling of togetherness or co-presence, increase the activity diversity and give different views and allow for real-time interaction. So this would help enhance the shared experience. Now, these are tools that can help you achieve some of this. So these softwares, the 360 view for various spaces in Poly Google, and then you have Unity, Cinema 4D, these can help you render, well, reasonably realistic rendering of the avatars. This is another tool that you might find handy, a 3D face mesh model that can help you the emotions or however the other person is reacting to the situations. You could make a more realistic rendering of all of those happen. And then the objective is that you should have an immersive shared experience which has interactivity, content curation, like I already pointed out. You know, there's lots and lots of information that is present. How do you make it appear as realistic as possible, and how do you make it dynamic? Well, dynamic, if you want to go for hiking, how do you make that experience dynamic? How does the hiking experience change from one hike to the next? Personalized, you know, so a person would want a certain kind of hike. So how do you make sure that there's always a lake view when this person goes on a hike, for example? So how can you do content curation? So that's one thing that you could do. You could look at use cases which implement a birthday party. You could implement a use case that does watching games together, or it could be visiting tourist sites together, or engaging in paragliding together, you know, any of these activities. But the challenge is making it interactive and making the content as realistic, as dynamic, and as personalized as possible. And these are, again, some of the suggested data resources. But as with the previous case, you can use other freely available sources if you so desire. Now, moving on to the third challenge. For this challenge, your point of contact is Amit, Dr. Amit Gupta at DBU. This is his email ID. You can contact him, or you could send a mail to Farin Fauzia. Either of these will be able to give you more details about what you're looking for. This is about improving the experience and specifically enhancing the immersiveness of video conferencing applications. So when you talk of video conferencing, a lot of you would probably be working or studying from home. So video conferencing, there are two aspects that we talk of here. When we say video conferencing and collaboration, there's exchange of information, but there's also exchange of information in form of whiteboard renderings, or in the form of shared videos or shared slides or shared documents. So collaboration is about being able to make changes, let's say, in a common document. How can you edit a video together while both of you are sitting at two different places? So those are the kind of things that fall under the purview of video collaboration. So the idea is to enhance the immersiveness of video conferencing and collaboration. So here, it's very verbal, so let me just tell you what this is. So video conferencing has been around for a long time, but there is this need to combine the modalities. By modalities, I mean speech, video, and shared content. There is a possibility of combining these multiple modalities in a manner that they make the best use of the situation. Here, what we want to do is that we want at the transmitting. So let me try to explain this with an example. Assume that the scenario that we are trying to improve is where a teacher is teaching his students. And everybody is at remote locations. They are connecting online. So there are two things that you would need to do. One is at the end of the teacher. At the end of the teacher, you need to extract all the information that you can from not just what he writes or not just what he says, but how is he saying it? What is he emphasizing on? All of those, gestures and body movements which make the sharing of knowledge richer. You have to make a sense of all of that and interpret it, infer it, and pass it on to the students who are listening to the teacher at different geographical locations online. And at this other end, what you need to do is every student is unique. The way he will consume information is different for each student. So how do you make subtle changes to the content that the teacher had passed on for the student so that each student is able to learn to the best of his or her capability? So that's the idea of this challenge. So here is the whiteboard example that I just talked about. So a simple thing that can, for example, be implemented is on which side of the whiteboard is the teacher. Is he pointing at the whiteboard repeatedly? Is he emphasizing on certain part of the content on the whiteboard? All of these things need to be interpreted and communicated to the students. And at the student side, they have to be translated into a format that is best consumed by the individual student. So now, what is it that you can do in this particular challenge? You can, from the full range of visual cues, posture, eye gaze, facial expressions, head nodding, gesturing, body movements, all of these provide very, very important information, especially when a teacher is teaching, because it is about emphasizing certain things. It's about making sure that certain parts of the content become ingrained in the minds of the student. Certain places you only give pointers, so you emphasize accordingly. So the emphasis should be very carefully captured by the algorithm that you develop. You should also be able to understand the interactions that the teacher has with the surroundings, and this will help in setting the context. And it is more important when you have a video conference, less important when you have a teacher teaching, because the teacher probably interacting just with the whiteboard and a PowerPoint. But if you have a video conferencing, then surrounding interactions become important. These are important cues that you will need to understand and encode. And then finally, what you need to do is the collaborative part. So you could choose to work on the collaborative part. What is the best way to combine multiple modalities? Shared content, how can two people work on it together? How can they work on it together without it becoming inconvenient or difficult? you know, imagine two people controlling the mouse of a single or trying to write on the same whiteboard. So who gets the control, why, how? So these are questions that need to be answered to make the experience better rather than worse. So here are two specific challenges that we've talked about. So what you do is, in a video conferencing, you could have a tool on the speaker side that extracts the local context. So you have the dressing style, facial grooming, ambient lighting. All of this will tell you something about the context of that video conference, and that can be captured and made, and that can be used to make the video conferencing experience more immersive. So on the other side, instead of having a video of the other person playing, you could have an animation, an avatar, but with realistic facial expressions, realistic body movements, realistic hand gestures. So this is, and the local context faithfully captured, dressing style, facial grooming, is it an informal setting or is it a formal setting? So that is what we need to do. So on the transmitter side, you need to extract this information. And on the receiver side, you have to have an anime rendering of this particular of the speaker as faithfully as is possible. And the other one is the teacher experience, which I've already spoken at length about, because that's the example I used to explain this challenge. So here are some inspirations. These are things that you could look at to understand how people are targeting immersive 3D. So here you have enough bandwidth to have any surface representations, or you can design your conference room in a manner that the people who participate remotely appear to be in the same room, or you could move the entire conference to the virtual world and avatars interact with each other. So both are possible ways of making the experience more immersive. The second one can also be a tool for shared experiences. What we are talking about in the first challenge is that because of the limitations of bandwidth, you might want to have avatars of the person rendered at the receiving end, but with high fidelity reproduction of the emotions, environment, and other important information about the person who's saying those words. And there's more here. And then finally, these are the data sources and references that you could work with. And here again, these are not the only ones that you might want to use. And now we could move on to questions. I've taken 5 minutes more than I intended to, but I hand it back to Thomas for questions.
Thank you so much, Professor Brajesh from India Institute of Technology, Delhi, for the wonderful, insightful presentation. There's, you know, it's three problem statements, so I believe that we have more questions that we're going to receive for explanations and some of the maybe aspects of the challenge. Now I'd like to invite my colleague Vishnu to take over for the Q&A session. So welcome, Vishnu, and please take over for the Q&A session.
Thank you, Thomas. And as usual, it is a pleasure to talk to you, Brajesh. You know, wonderful talk. What a breadth. I mean, you covered three of those very important problem statements. In my opinion, it's amazing. A couple of questions from my side. Let me take advantage and ask you some doubts. One of the things is that it's very interesting, your talk. I think you never mentioned the word AI or ML. You mentioned the word neural networks once. I was trying to count. It's quite interesting because it looks like you have crossed this sound barrier between the technique and the application of it. This is very, very interesting to me. But however, I want to ask you this question. In terms of tool sets, as a judge, so let us say you are judging these participants who are coming in, do you have some recommendations on what are the tool sets they should be using, what kind of ML techniques they should be using? Is there any criteria, first of all? Suppose you get a solution, how are you going to evaluate? Could you give some tips on the tool sets evaluation that you are going to do, please?
Okay. Thank you for that question, Vishnu. So yeah, that's something that I did not talk about the evaluation part. So before that, the evaluation part is something that I will, talk about, but what tools they should build, what algorithms they should make, and what ML techniques they should use is something that I will be silent about, because the idea of challenge is to make them think. So you know, I did mention a couple of things that we've done in our lab here, but I, on purpose, try to keep that out of this presentation. The reason for that is that, new ideas come only if there are no biases. So I don't want to bias anybody. So that's the first point. The second point is, before I talk about the evaluation, is the not the use of word AI and ML. So like I said, because I'm a signal processing person who's moved into ML and AI. So AI is a given. So when I talk of somebody implementing an algorithm, it is a foregone conclusion that we will be using ML or AI for that. So I think the world has reached a stage where a lot of people use AI as a tool almost without thinking. That's the first tool that comes to their mind, and they end up making a solution using that. However, interestingly and ironically, I did talk about handcrafting, which is the exact opposite of learning. So you actually understand the situation yourself and handcraft features. So that is something that we did, and that is the only thing I talked about. So sorry, digress. Now coming back to how is it going to be evaluated? So now, as you can see, most of the things that we talk about here are about experience. So when you talk about experience, there is a high degree of subjectivity that is involved. So each of these challenges will have a different way of finding out what the error is. The first one is the easiest to measure and to find out how the challenger performed, because how many pedestrians did he miss, for example, is a metric that we will be able to calculate. How many or how far is his predicted track from the actual track? So the first one will have the regular measures that you have for any learning technique. However, the point that you make is very valid for the second two challenges, because the second two challenges are about immersive experience and about shared experience. So it isn't about the quality of an image or quality of a video where people have slowly moved from using subjective measures to objective or mathematical measures which do capture perception. So when you talk of experience, you are very, very far away from having measures for how good the experience was. However, having said that, we can still have measures of the realism of the rendering. So how close is the rendering, the anime rendering, as opposed to the original person? So how correctly were the dress captured? So those for there, that you can have numbers, but the taste of the so actually the final thing will only happen in the experience, and that will be subjective. So some amount of evaluation will happen based on how the judges experience the solutions of the different participants.
That's very interesting. Yeah, thank you so much. In fact, I think that brings me to my second question. That is, your problem statement about driving in India. I think that's a very interesting problem. In fact, many times when I have my friends come over from abroad, and I take them around, and they're bewildered. I mean, they think I am some kind of Superman driving around, because it's amazing the amount of variety of things that we have on the roads. So I think my question is about the sensing inputs, the number of inputs, and the limits to the sources of information that we can have. I think here is the difference between the developed kind of environment. Even we have some places in India too, as you say, but the difference between the number of inputs that we can have in a structured environment and as unstructured environment is quite huge. So in the because your problem statement is specifically related to unstructured environment, my question is, do we look at some limits on the number of sources of input, or is that really not a criteria for you?
Okay, so that again is a very good question, Vishnuji. So let me just answer this at two levels. One is at the challenge level and the other is at a slightly higher level. At the challenge level, we are looking at the participants to restrict themselves to largely optical devices and take inputs from there. The way they are going to limit what they do is they can either focus on scene understanding or they can focus on recommendation. And within scene understanding, they can focus on, let us say, pedestrian trajectory, or they can focus on presence of animals on the road, or they could focus on potholes. So as you correctly point out, it is almost impossible in such a short period with structured sensing to come up with a solution for an unstructured problem. So that is the first part of the question. So they will have, so when they discuss this problem with us, we will put limits or constraints in terms of the scope, the modality, and the type of unstructured entity that they're looking at. Now, to answer this question in a more complete way, what you say is absolutely right. Some of the best drivers in the country meaning India, are not formally taught driving. They pick it up as they drive. They start at a young age, they are scolded by their boss, and you know, lo and behold, 10 years later, they can find their way around the toughest of traffic scenarios. So to solve for the unstructured world, we will require as many modalities as come, but the machine does not have to be trained only in the traffic scenario. So this is something that I find extremely intriguing, and I think has a future, is machines that will be trained for in environments which are very different where they'll eventually be used. So you train a machine just to understand a language. You train a machine just to find its way indoors and a lot of other things. And once it has been trained, you also train it to get inputs from other people. Unless you do that, you will not be able to provide a solution that can work on structured inputs and give you a good inferencing in an unstructured environment. So that problem can only be solved when you have a machine that learns a lot of other things, not just finding its way in traffic.
Very interesting. That's a very good answer. I want to ask one of the questions which is here, right here. I think it is a very good question as well. The role of 5G and the networks and the communication latencies and such things. As you know, the situation is improving. We have better connectivity these days. But I mean, I think the word unstructured applies there as well. So my question is, how in this as you call it, quote unquote, chaotic situation of latency throughput issues that we have, and even sometimes outages. So what kind of techniques role does this communication network play in these problem statements, especially the automated driving, assisted driving kind of scenarios that you discussed in this problem statement? What is the role of these challenges in these communication networks in this?
Yeah, thank you for that question. So MN Suma. Okay, so that is a good question. Now, if you've noticed, the challenge that we gave on immersive conferencing required you to render animations on the receiver side. The reason for that was low quality video in a country like India. You know, the reason for extracting a lot of information. So there are two reasons for finding out what a person is doing, because you could extract that and store it for later retrieval. And the other is because you have a poor connectivity, you just send that inference. And at the other end, you have a model of the speaker and you render the avatar. So that is one way of overcoming that problem. So when you come to, when you start talking about road conditions, in road conditions, you will not be able to move to autonomy till the network is fixed. And that is not happening anytime soon in India. So we focus on recommendation for the driver. The difference between autonomous driving and driver assistance is not what your algorithm does. It is what the car is able to do with that algorithm. In autonomous driving, the car can take that inference and do what it wants. But in driver assistance, the driver has to use that, use his judgment and drive the car. So as you very, very correctly point out, Soma, we cannot change the network. But what we can do is use the network differently. And I've given you examples of using the network differently in two of the three challenges that we have encountered.
Thank you. I think that's a very good answer as well. I think you talked a little bit about this coexistence. I think you are talking about the car scenario. You talked about the coexistence of different kinds of the vehicles with and without V2X, and that's the context that you were talking about. I think I have the same question about this kind of recommendation systems with the vehicles with and without these recommendation systems, and it can be extended to the other challenges that you mentioned as well. How do you see this playing out? Does it play any role at all in the challenge and in general? I would like to hear your views in general as well. How does this coexistence play along in this sort of scenario that we are definitely going to have it. We are going to have both the haves and the have-nots, as we call it, right? So how do you see it happening?
Right. Now that is a tough question, because what happens is, as a technologist, it is easy to work on a problem, come up with an algorithm, find an engineering solution and put it up for use. But will it benefit the society or make it worse is something that one must always try to keep in mind, but we forget to do so. So I will try to answer the question that you asked, Vishnuji. So what happens is, when you build technology, clearly you start thinking about the haves. You start building it for the people who have access to it. But what happens is, after a while, when you raise your level, a lot of other people become more and more informed. What is happening in a country like India, for example, is a lot more people do not have. But what has changed is that they now know that they do not have it. So whenever a technology is built for the people who can afford it, it percolates down to some parts of the people who cannot afford it at this time. But they certainly come to know that there is something that they are missing. So this leads to two things. Some of these people try to work harder or try to work different and raise their level of living, which means that some of the technology becomes available to them. But there is this other set that becomes more and more disgruntled and after a certain time has to be addressed too. So some of the interesting work that we are doing for 6G is about focusing on remote connectivity. And the reason why remote connectivity is becoming important is because rural is also classified as remote. So while you're talking of 5G for the urban population, you don't even have 2G for a large part of the rural population. So this is now beginning to pinch. So now then, when we look at the standardization effort for 6G, one of the verticals that we are looking at is remote connectivity. So there will be a gap, but eventually, I think in two ways. One is people themselves rise, and two, the difference becomes so large that you cannot live with that difference. You end up bridging it. So eventually everybody gains the benefits.
Interesting, interesting. I think that's a practical answer too. I think we have seen it in the case of phone connectivity, mobile connectivity. It has happened, I mean, in the past. So I think that's a very good answer. I know we are losing time. I just can't help asking you this question. There is this word in Hindi. There is this word called jugad. Jugad, I think you made a very nice phrase for it in this talk. You were talking about ingenuity. Ingenuity. Yeah, that is a very innovative trait, I should say. What is the role in your challenges to this? Would you reward or would you penalize? What would you think for jugad or ingenuity, whatever you call it?
Oh, okay. So before I answer for this, let me tell you two things about ingenuity or jugad. So those from not from India, jugad is the word that I will use because it sounds very appropriate. Okay, but it means ingenuity, using whatever you have in the best manner possible. That is what jugad is. So for me, jugad is important when you have done whatever you could have done well in a structured manner. That is when you start looking at jugad. So for me, for this challenge, at least I'm not looking at jugad. I'm looking at people coming up with new ideas. I want them to push the boundaries. You do jugad when you can push the boundaries no further. How do you use the resources in the best manner possible? I will not penalize ingenuity, but I will strongly encourage new innovative ideas.